In this talk, I'll try to describe some of the work we have been doing in the area of nanocarbon. So, this talk, I will just try to highlight what are the interesting issues, and I will leave some of the details out which can be discussed with me if needed later. All of you know about carbon, that it has this two allotropic forms, which we know for a very, very long time. From this diamond and graphite, what was missing was some mysteries, and this is the humanly intervention which really made the field explode. So from the interstellar dust, it was seen that there are some structural lines which cannot be explained by the known elements we know. So theorists proposed that some of these lines might come from linear carbon chain. So in order to understand these lines, this mystery of these lines, there was an attempt to make a linear carbon chain by laser ablation of graphite. And that laser ablation, when it led to the mass spec, gave rise to the discovery of C60. So the C60 discovery came around 1985, and this led to a large activity in this area with this beautiful 7-angstrom molecule, and 1996 was the Nobel Prize in Chemistry to the discoverer of this fullerene. So when this was there, in the same around the same time, 1 year later, in the arc discharge process, a group found led by Japanese Ijima and others, that you can form multi-wall carbon nanotubes. So these are concentric sheets of graphite with inter-tube gap of about 3.4 angstrom, same as in graphite. And 93 saw the discovery of single wall carbon nanotube. So this single wall carbon nanotube is about 1 or 2 nanometer and few micron long. So now 93 was the discovery of single wall nanotube, and you all know that how it has changed the scene in the last science scene in the last 10 years. It has enormous exceptional properties, be it mechanical properties, be it electrical properties, and so on. And now also in medicine and nano-agriculture, there are applications. So this nanotubes, it is no surprise that if you look at Web of Science, how many papers are appearing, what is the citation, it is really mind-boggling. For single wall nanotube, last year was 1400 papers, and citations were about 40,000. So you can see, and multi-wall also, it's a huge activity. So not only in publications, but also in the market. So there is a tremendous market already, and it is expected that 2011 will be $1 billion market, which will encompass composites, electronics, energy sectors, and so on. So you can see from a simple discovery in 1991-93, in last 20 years, not only very exciting science has come, but it has also led to many, many applications. So in all this game, we started with three-dimensional carbon, we came to zero-dimensional carbon, because it's a confined system. Then we came to one-dimensional carbon, namely nanotubes. So what was missing in this happy family was two-dimensional carbon. And what is a two-dimensional carbon? A single sheet of carbon. So this is what was missing, and this gap was unambiguously and unquestionably answered by this Manchester group, where they used an extraordinarily simple technique of using scotch tape, putting on the graphite, peeling it off, and then putting it on any substrate. That led to, I will show you, an enormous surge in the activity. So 2004 was this paper in Science, and this year Nobel Prize went to these two people from Manchester, Andre Geim and Novoselov, 36 year old as of now, a remarkable explosion of activities. And the citation reads on the web page, for groundbreaking experiments regarding the two-dimensional material graphene. So within 6 years of the discovery, they have been recognized by this Nobel Prize this year. So now there are many other methods. This is the method which they launched. Now you can produce by chemical vapor deposition of methane on copper or nickel. You can have by chemical route, you can make colloidal suspensions. You can heat silicon carbide. Also you can, by that way you will get graphene and so on. So there are lots of methods now where you can grow graphene on a large scale. Not only the mechanical exfoliation which was demonstrated in 2004. So since, as I said, there is a pedagogical component to this meeting, so let me start by reminding what we already know for a two-dimensional layer of carbon, like a graphene. So you have two atoms per unit cell, A and B. They are the same carbon, but they form a unit cell. So what you have is sp2 hybridization, and you form the sigma bond. So what is of interest for all the key properties are these pz orbitals of carbon, which are the pi electrons. So now you can look at the band structure, what is their energy momentum relationship, which was done way back in 1948. And it was shown that, without going into details, you can write down the Schrodinger equation for the electrons, but then you can show in a very simple tight-minding picture that it really reduces to a Dirac equation, which is for the effective massless particle. But the most important thing is that the energy of this electron is linear in momentum at this point in the Brillouin zone. This linear relationship is same as for photons, but now instead of velocity of light, you have the Fermi velocity. So whatever you know of photons, question is what could be happening for electrons. So for normal conventional metals and semiconductors, energy relationship is quadratic. Momentum is k square, energy is k square or t square over 2m. So you can see that it has Hamiltonian is exactly that of the Dirac particle. But now what replaces the real spin of electron, here it is replaced by a pseudo spin. Why? Because any electronic state at the Fermi level will have contributions from the A sublattice, B sublattice. So there is a pseudo spin operator, it's not the real spin, which replaces the actual spin of the photon, and this is the Dirac equation. So in graphene, you have massless electrons, effective massless electrons, which move with a Fermi velocity, and there are many consequences of this simple fact which are being explored. This is from this review article. I just say that this is for a conventional semiconductor or a metal, and this is for the graphene. Because of this, it's a high school textbook exercise to show that the density of states will be linear in energy. Again, many interesting consequences come as compared to a conventional 2D electron gas, and this linearity also is at the back of many interesting physics. Now, what is so exciting about graphene? We have been hearing for the last 8 years. First, of course, it is very strong but flexible. So it has been shown that this is the strongest material you can ever have, and it is flexible. So they took the graphene, they punched their fist, which is a AFM tip, and then they deform it, and then they return back, they retract. It recovers its shape. So in the Science paper in 2008, these people showed that this is the strongest and the most flexible material. Diamond is strong, but it is not flexible. So this is a very unique property. And another thing is that they have, there is a very nice, many manifestation of 2 plus 1 dimensional quantum electrodynamics. In the morning talk which was being given, QED was being discussed in the context of high energy physics and string theory. Here, whatever were the exotic phenomena described by relativistic quantum mechanics, people are trying to do those experiments in the laboratory on graphene. So graphene is a single element laboratory for quantum electrodynamics, and that is why it is so exciting. But also these have a large mobility of this electron even at room temperature. Because of that, you can play quantum billiards. You can take a graphene sheet and shoot an electron into it. When you shoot it, it will not be a random walk. It will go like a bullet and return. This is the ballistic motion which occurs in graphene. So in this paper, they show beautiful experiments that the quantum billiard effects or quantum billiard-like things can happen in graphene coming from the ballistic transport. Now you can also have a quantum Hall effect, because if you have a two-dimensional electron gas, you know that quantum Hall effect was discovered in other devices. It was shown in these devices even at room temperature. You don't need helium. So even at room temperature, it has been shown this nice exotic state in graphene. But more recently, it was shown that these electrons in graphene are not independent. They are talking to each other. Correlations are important. If the correlations are important, it is known that it should lead to fractional quantum Hall effect, which was discovered in other systems, and that discovery was done last year. So very nice properties of graphene are being explored in the quantum domain and non-quantum domain. Why? That is why it is making a great impact in physical and chemical sciences. Many applications are being expected and being worked on. Devices from the graphene, ultra high frequency devices, because you have a ballistic transport, you can use it as a transmission electron microscope grid for drug delivery of water insoluble compounds. You can make a graphene transparent sheet on a glass and make it conducting. Glass is transparent but not conducting, which you need in solar cell applications, liquid crystal display, and so on. So the material of choice there is indium tin oxide. You can replace that with graphene layer, where the transmission is almost 85% and the conductivity is very high. So you can make it into gas sensors, biosensors. I'll show you resistive switching effects which have been discovered recently. I'll give you our results on this. Many memory devices and so on. So this is a very partial list of graphene applications in many areas. And no wonder there are patents already in last few years. And this year the 160 patents have been filed in 2009. And most of them are in applications, 55%, 18% in processing, and 27% in synthesis. So you can see that not only the physics is exciting, which is shown in this graph, that how many citations on graphene per year after the discovery of the effect. So nanotubes were discovered, so you plot within 7 years of their discovery, this is the blue line. But graphene is the red line, and already within 2 years, the citations is 25,000 per year. And the latest count as of last week, which my student did, is that 2010, the citations are already 45,000 of papers on graphene. And the papers are about 2,000 this year. And this year is still not over, another month is there. So you can see this huge explosion of activity, not only in the number of papers, also in citation, is telling us that there is an exciting science and many possible applications which people are exploring. And in all this nanocarbon, it is gratifying to see that the Raman scattering, which was discovered by Sir Raman in 1928, for which he got the Nobel Prize in 1930, has a very key player, is a key player. Because the characterization and study of these materials is uniquely done by Raman scattering. So this, for example, if you have a nanotube, it has a phonon, it's a vibration. How does nanotube vibrates? That is a frequency. That frequency you can measure in Raman scattering. So the frequency depends on the diameter of the tube. So just by a simple experiment, you can measure the diameter of single wall nanotube, which is about 1 to 2 nanometer. Otherwise, you have to do transmission electron microscope and AFM and so on. So this simple method tells you what is the diameter, what is the purity of nanotubes and so on. And nanotubes can be metallic as well as semiconducting. So if you look at this high frequency modes, which is related to the vibration of the carbon atoms on the nanotube, this is very different if it is a metallic tube or a semiconducting tube. So just by a simple experiment, you can find out the diameter of the nanotube and the type of nanotube which you are making and using. So this talk, I'll focus only on graphene. My group works a lot on nanotubes and related applications if they come. But this talk, since it is, I thought instead of cluttering the whole talk with too many results, let me just focus only on graphene and tell you what we are looking at and where we are trying to understand. So the first part of my talk is to show you how you can very trivially make, very easily make a field effect transistor of a graphene, which has been done, but I'll tell you what is the new thing we have brought in and what you can do with it. Using that, you can make a very, very simple frequency multiplier. You give a frequency of omega, you will get 2 omega out from these devices because of the property of the, I'll point out. You can make resisting switching devices, which are called memristors, the resistance which is a memory. Then I'll tell you the second part, that how you can use Raman scattering and transport together to understand these devices. Why? Because you need to know what is limiting these devices. What is the electron phonon coupling? Why electrons are getting scattered? All those issues which come eventually in deciding the usefulness of a device, you can do by Raman scattering when the device is working under a microscope. So you make a device working, look at Raman scattering in situ and try to understand. So the physics of these devices is which we use to do Raman to this. So this slide is to put on record enormous work done by my graduate students in the last few, and some of the publications which have details that Anindya, who is now in Weizmann Institute, Vishwanath, who is just completing, and Siddharth Vasu, Siddheshwara Vasu, who is doing graphene made by chemical route. You can make tons of graphene now using chemical route. So we have been using those and so on. So just let me start by telling you some of the results. So when you make graphene and put it on a substrate, you can do AFM, you can show it a single layer, but the color contrast is very specific if it is a single layer or a bilayer. So how do you make this device? The simplest route known to mankind, scotch tape, which they discovered. Take a scotch tape from your drawer, put it on HOPG, which is a highly oriented graphite, peel it off, and then that tape, you touch it on the SiSiO2 substrate. If you do it correctly, watch it under a microscope, you will locate many, many single layers, many bilayers, trilayers, and so on. And then you go ahead and make devices. So this is the way they showed in 2004. There are YouTube videos on this. You can, I'm sure youngsters here are on the YouTube all the time. You can just put a keyword, graphene fabrication, and you will get beautiful videos on it. And this is very, very easy to make. So, when you do Raman scattering on this, the uniqueness is that not only you have a G mode, which is a characteristic of graphite or graphene, but you have this mode called a 2D mode. I will not go into detail. This is a mode which has no business to be in this spectrum. It is not Raman allowed. So this is a double of this mode, which is even absent. So the first order cousin is absent, but its second order cousin, which is supposed to be much weaker, is having a huge intensity. So there is a nice physics behind it, and this gives you a number of layers in the sample. So this is a characteristic feature of single layer. When you make a bilayer, what you will see is this mode is similar, but this mode, which is one peak, splits into four peaks. So immediately you can make out whether the sample which you have identified is a single layer or a bilayer. If you have a trilayer, this signature changes. So the number of layers have uniqueness in the fingerprints in Raman spectra, and this is what people in graphene field use. What is this mode? I will not go into detail. This is a mode not at the Brillouin zone. Those who do Raman scattering will appreciate that any other mode requires impurities and so on. I will not go into, but the 2D mode is not symmetric out, and it has information on the band structure of graphene and hence on the number of layers. So you make a device. How do you make a device? I think it is getting cut. It is just written field defect transistor. It is a canonical device you make first, and using that you can make many other devices. So this is the hydrogen atom problem of electronics. So you put the graphene between the two electrodes. This distance is about 2 to 4 micron. Put it on a gate which is called SiO2 and apply the voltage, the gate voltage. So it's a three terminal device where you control the conductivity of graphene using the gate voltage. So this is the off state and this is the on state. So this is called hole doping, this is called electron doping. And here the voltages are about 100 volts. So by applying this voltage, you can change the Fermi level in the graphene or the doping in the graphene. So you can dope electron dope or a hole dope. And the devices have many issues, which I said, what is the electron phonon coupling and so on. All these are issues which have to be understood for any new material. What we have done is a small trick. It is known that in the literature you can do electrochemical gating. So instead of using 300 nanometer of gate, what we have done is we don't use this. We put a drop of solid electrolyte. It is a polymer with lithium perchlorate. Now here, when you apply a gate, which is a platinum wire or a gold wire, between these two electrodes, you form a debilayer near the graphene. Means ions come nearby. Now the debilayer thickness, you all know, is 1 nanometer or so. So instead of 300 nanometer of gate, you have 1 nanometer now. So whatever you could do with 100 volts, now you can do with less than a volt, and you can do a heavy doping of this graphene. So the interesting thing is this electrochemical doping allows a very large doping. Also this electrolyte, which is a solid electrolyte, it's a thin layer, it is transparent, it's optically transparent. So you can do Raman scattering when the device is working. So you do, I have a slide here, or maybe come later. When the device is working, you can do Raman scattering. So the punchline of this is that the top gated electrochemical gating, where the debilayer acts like a gate instead of 300 nanometer of SiO2, makes the life very simple, and with 1 volt or less you can change the Fermi level. So this is what we have been doing. So once you do this, you can plot source drain current as a function of gate voltage. Please see, it is not 100 volt, it is -1 volt to +1 volt. This is a hole doping, these are the electrodes. And you can show what is the resistivity of this device. You can fit to a model, we do that, and you can show that this device and at room temperature had about 300 centimeter square per volt second. So this device has some very uniqueness. What is the uniqueness? That it is symmetric around the Dirac point. This is the Dirac point, no doping. So you put hole doping or electron doping, and it is quite symmetric. Because, and also this is happening for few volts. This is the back gate, same device. This is the top gate. Now, an important property of a device is transconductance, DIS over DVG. If you want that to be high, here it is nano Siemens in the back gate. But in our way of doing, it is micro Siemens. So, a very simple small voltage has a huge change in the transconductance. So, this is one beauty. And second is, it is symmetric around this, whether you go holes or electrons, it is symmetric because of this linear dispersion and the linear density of states with energy. So, this feature we have exploited recently in the following way. It is known recently that people have used graphene to make frequency multiplier. So, here it is done with the top gate or top gate using atomic layer deposition, using some hafnium oxide and so on, and the other way. So, what is the idea? Let me give you the idea. So, the idea is that if you operate this device at this point and you apply the gate voltage, not a DC but an AC of a certain frequency, you can easily show, I'll try to show that, that the output will be double in frequency. Why? When the cycle is positive, it is doing hole doping. And then the cycle is negative, as negative is doing hole doping, positive is doing electron doping. And the fact that this graph is symmetric around electron and hole, you will get the doubling of the frequency because twice it is doing it in any cycle, positive or negative. And if you do here, you can show that the output will be same frequency, which is in phase, and this will be out of phase. So a very simple device gives you a frequency multiplier in phase and out of phase response. So what is done? You make a device, put the polymer electrolyte, and in this gate you apply a AC voltage instead of a DC voltage. So DC voltage tweaks where you want to operate, and this is what the frequency of interest. And you look at the output here, and this output you can easily show will have the frequency doubling. So you, let us see the experiments. For example, this is the device, our device. You put it here, a frequency of 800 Hz, and what you get is this red graph, which is 1600 Hz. And if you are at this point, you get the same frequency. So, a very simple graphene frequency multiplier, and many, many variants of this idea now are possible with these devices. And this is what Vishwanath is doing. So, you can show this, and you can also show that if you operate it slightly close to this, you will show, I will not have time, that not only you get the same frequency, you also get the double frequency. So it depends on what you want to get. So you can get frequency doubling, you can get in phase output and out of phase output, as well as both the frequencies present. This is what you can do. The second device which I just want to discuss, which is again very interesting, is called resistive RAM or memristor. So what is this device? So here if you look at this IEEE spectrum website, they call it the greatest invention of the last 25 years. And there are a lot of press hype. Time magazine has called it the best invention of 2008 and so on. So there is a lot of hype, there is a lot of reality. So let me tell you what this is hype. So this is again a high school graph which has been discussed in this paper, but with a very important prediction. So this paper predicted that you have any circuit parameters, high school, what are the things? Charge, current, voltage, magnetic flux. We all know that. We grew up with that. You have voltage and current, you get a resistance. You have voltage and charge, you get a capacitance. You get magnetic flux and current, you get inductance. So what was missing here was this connection between magnetic flux and charge. Is there a connection? Because if you want by analogy what would be possible. And it was predicted here, yes, it is a possibility, no fundamental physics rules it out, and what you will, they showed that the voltage will be proportional to current like a resistance, but that resistance will depend on the charge trap. So it will be having a resistance which will have memory. So even if you switch off the voltage, the resistance will remain the same, or you can change it by changing the input voltage. And this is what was shown, is called the resistive ramp switching. So the idea is that you can first plot current versus voltage. You have a low current, this is the ohmic law, but suddenly the device goes to a high current. So you now have a device low current to high current, which means high resistance to low resistance. And now once you form it, you can say next time when you do, you can show that you can have on off device, and this device will remain there unless you apply another voltage. So this is called a unipolar or a bipolar. I will not go into detail, but the idea is the most of the devices of this, there is a huge action in this front. It's a very simple device. You put bottom electrode, you put the material of interest, transition metal oxide, and you put a top electrode, which are here. And using the voltage between this and this, you can make this memristor or the resistive switching devices. And you can see that this is a $1 billion industry with lot of players in this game to have the commercial application of RRAM or memristor. So it's a very, very exploding field like graphene for this. So what we have done is a small experiment, but with an idea. We make a graphene device, we put it on a conducting plate, this is the graphene layer, and then we put a electrode, and when we apply the voltage, what we show, I'll just show you the results, that if you have, you look at the red graph, the current versus voltage, current jumps here, you get a huge current, almost 1 milliampere, you come back, and it goes to again the high resistance state. Now when you go from the high resistance state, come back, and again it goes to the low resistance state. So you can now switch between high resistance and low resistance as you wish. But the beauty is, can you do with a pulsed laser, pulsed thing. So what is done, you apply a voltage which is 8 volt pulse for 1 millisecond. What will it do? You look at this, 8 volt is a high resistance device, and when you apply 4 volt, it is this device. The fact that this is a device has a memory, you will lock that memory there, and this is what we show in this experiment. So here you have an 8 volt, it switches from here to the high resistance, and it will remain off for a very long time if you don't do anything with time. But if you come back and apply another voltage of 4 volt, it will come back to this thing. And this you can do repeated switching. So what we have shown is that it's a very, very stable device, and this device resistance ratio, on-off ratio, is 10 is power 5. It's an enormous contrast with this graphene device. So same thing we did with nanotubes, I will not go into, and what is the physics, we believe it is related to some nano cracks which are playing a role, which have been invoked in other experiments, but we still don't have a microscopic mechanism of this device. So at this stage, let me tell you the third part of my talk, that once you make this field effect transistor, how do you understand them? And I mentioned that we use Raman scattering along with the transport measurement to understand. So what do? So we make a device, this is 5 micron size graphene. We put two electrodes, gold, for example, gold. These are called source and drain. Now this is put on a SiO2, and this is the gate electrode. So in past, as I said, people are applying the back gate between source and the gate. Now as I mentioned few minutes back, what we apply is the top gate. So you make this device, put a single drop of this polymer called polyethylene oxide with lithium perchlorate. This electrolyte is used commercially also in lithium ion batteries and so on. So this you put a drop and you have an electrode inserted, or if you can make an electrode by other means also and apply a gate voltage. So what happens when you apply a gate voltage? Ions from the polymer will come near graphene and they will form a debye layer. This is what I mentioned. So 1 nanometer thick debye layer or so acts like a gate. And that is what switches the device from an off state to an on state. Once your device is working, at command, you can fill it with electrons or holes as you wish and reversibly. Now we want to do what these electrons are doing to the device, which means to the phonons. So phonons in any material are the characteristic signature. So what we do is, we look at Raman scattering when the device is working at different voltages. So we put different amount of doping and look Raman scattering. We look at the frequency of two modes which I mentioned, around 1580 and 2700 wave number, and they change dramatically with voltage. So the next graph shows that this frequency, when the electrons are not there, there is no doping of graphene, you have Dirac point. There are no Fermi level is at the Dirac point. This is the frequency 1582. But moment you go, you get a huge increase, 30 wave number increase within one voltage. Completely reversible if you bring the voltage back. But the 2D mode, which is at another point, it hardens with hole doping, softens with electron doping. So you can see that the nature of the doping does not affect the G mode, but it affects the 2D mode. And combination of this you can use to get the doping and the nature of doping in your sample. But this is not what we want only. We want to know why this is happening and what information we can get. And for this, I need to appeal to quantum mechanics. What does quantum mechanics say? Quantum mechanics says that you have what are the any particle, let's say phonon, it is dressed by the electron. So these are called quasi particles in condensed matter physics. So this dressing of a phonon, making into a quasi particle by because of electron dressing, has all the information on this electron phonon coupling. How electrons are coupled to phonons or how they get scattered. So the idea is that if you have a band structure, these are all electrons filled to valence band, no electrons here. Now, what quantum mechanically, physically you are doing, a phonon is able to make a transition across the valence band to the conduction band. This action leads to the dressing up of a phonon. So, the phonon frequency can change, phonon lifetime can change. Now, what happens when they start doping, these transitions will be forbidden because there is no state available. So, the simple physical picture tells you that when you put doping, when you put electrons or holes, some of the phonon assisted transition will be blocked. This blocking changes the dressing up of a phonon. It has to readjust, and because of that, the frequency changes, lifetime changes. So this is analyzed in the quantum mechanics language, and by this whole process, which I will not go into detail, you get a very important parameter called electron-phonon coupling, which means how strongly are they coupled, how much is the effect of this scattering. So this quantitative information you can now get from these structures, and this is what we have been doing in single layer, bilayer and so on. So there is I will not elaborate much, but again these are matter of details. If your graphene has defects, what will happen? So the defects again have a very unique role in deciding the electron mobility. And again we analyze this problem using Raman scattering. So I will not go into detail, but tell you that defects have a unique role to play. If it was bilayer, it will be different. Why? Because the band structure of bilayer is different. Why should it be different? Again, for the sake of students, these are two layers now, two graphene layers. Obviously they will talk to each other. Moment they talk, you will immediately see that you will not have one valence band and one conduction band and one valence band. Now you will have two conduction band and two valence band, because these two layers are interacting. And this energy will depend on how strongly they interact. But you want to measure them, because nobody tells you what is the number. All this can be again done using Raman scattering, photo emission experiments and so on. And we have shown recently that when you make a device out of bilayer, you get very interesting effects which are not the same as single layer. So let me not go into detail, but tell you that results are different for single layer and bilayer. And this all this quantum way of looking at it, which I pointed out, helps us to make quantitative predictions on this coupling between these layers and so on. You can have another thing, which again for curiosity. You are measuring I versus B of a device. Is it always ohmic? Is it always linear? You can show that by playing with the gate voltage, you can get very, very non-linear graphs. IV need not be ohmic. And the physics of that is that if you play with the gate voltage and source drain voltage, the graphene need not be uniformly doped. It is not that the entire graphene is electron doped, entire graphene is P doped and so on. You can have a situation, half of it can be P doped, half of it can be N doped. This means you can have a PN junction without doing any chemistry in the graphene layer by playing with the gate voltage. Indeed, we did that. And how do we confirm? Again, you do Raman scattering as a function of distance. So this is micro Raman. So your spatial resolution is high. You do Raman scattering when the device is working along the length. Look at this. If you do Raman scattering at this point, 1582 frequency. Same device, same condition, you do it here, it is 1593. And quantitative analysis tells you what is the profile of the carrier in this layer. So this is something again you can do quantitatively. The last part of my presentation is to tell you how to make 5 cent devices. Somebody said 13 cent for helium and so on. So it's a 5 cent device. How? You can make now graphene in tons by chemical route. So you can start with graphite, you can exfoliate by chemical method. So these layers go separate. Then you can treat it with acid, which is called graphene oxide. You can oxidize it. Then you can do the sonication, all these layers come out in a solution. These layers have lot of oxygen attached, oxygen groups. Those things you can again reduce and make graphene, single layer or bilayer. This is called reduced graphene oxide, because they still have some oxygen. You can make them in as much quantity as you want. Now you can make two electrodes in the lab. This is about a 3 micron gap. I put the drop of that graphene here, put it and apply a RF field, a radio frequency field, for 1 minute. Once you do that, for the nice physics reason, the graphene comes and deposits here. And this device is which shows conductivity, it shows resistance versus temperature, and this resistance variation is exactly same as a single layer mechanically exfoliated graphene. So we confirm that is a single layer graphene made by chemical route. And sure enough, we do the gate voltage and it shows a hole doping and electron doping. Again, you can use these devices for sensors applications and for understanding the physics. So now you can make this device from the chemically produced graphene, and you can really make them in huge quantities at a very low cost. So this again some features which I will not discuss. Another interesting thing is this graphene is on this substrate, which is SiO2 on Si. Obviously substrate has some effect because it will influence graphene. So there is a big effort to suspend this graphene on two bridges. So the graphene should not touch the substrate. That was the way it was done to get high mobility graphene, which led to fractional quantum Hall effect. You can do that. So this is a graph SCM from my lab. This is the graphene on these two bridges, and there is a gap here. And this is done again by etching method. So now you can make devices which need not be on a substrate. So again, this also acts like a cantilever and MEMS device. So lot of things you can do with this. So I just close this talk just with a humbling thought that the next time, especially students, when you use pencil and leave a mark on a pencil, please be respectful, because what you are leaving behind is graphene, and what you are leaving behind is enormous physics capability on that single or bilayer graphene. So this is something which makes us feel humble, and with this I thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Sood, for a very interesting talk. We have some time for questions. Yes.
A substitute for ITO layer, the graphene layer, is it now commercially available? And what would be the stability?
This is not my work. There are beautiful papers which have shown this highly conducting and transparent layer. They have achieved, which we have also achieved. Once you make chemically produced graphene, you can spread on any place you want. Okay, so people have grown this graphene layer on 6-inch glass. Resistivity is low, but transmission is still 85%. If 85% is acceptable for some application, it is fine. But if you want 90% or 95%, then you will have to work on it.
What about stability? Will it be stable? Yeah,
very stable.
In electrolytes, strong acidic and alkaline.
Carbon is highly stable. You can beat it up.
Okay. Thank you. My next question would be that if we have a graphene layer and we deposit some oxide over it, now according to your experiments, can we supply electron and holes to make that oxide grown over graphene, p-type and n-type, in that way?
Should be. I don't know if it has been done, but I don't see any reason not to.
I mean, making oxides grown over graphene.
Yeah. If there is a good reason to do, you should do it.
Yeah.
And there is, because people have grown, I didn't elaborate on it. People are making graphene ferroelectric heterostructures. And some of the ferroelectrics can be liquid crystal, some of them can be oxide. Now, this sandwich, ferroelectric graphene, has very interesting memory properties. The retention of whatever you write, and this is what is being done.